Hey serverless friends, welcome to another lesson of Azure Functions University. My name is Mark Duiker and I'm going to talk about HTTP triggers with .NET 6 this time. Before we dive into the lesson, let's have a look at the GitHub repository. You can go to the repository by going to this link and you'll end up right here, the Azure Functions University repo on GitHub that contains all of the lessons. But also all of the source codes of all the demos that that I'll be showing you. And it's not only for .NET 6 lessons, but also for the .NET Core lessons, and we have lessons for TypeScript and PowerShell and Python. So yeah, you can see that we have a lot of content there already, but I'm also always looking for new contributions. So if you want to fill one of these gaps here by providing a lesson, then please raise an issue or look at the existing issues, because maybe there's already an issue out there where you can help out. But today I'll be talking about the HTTP trigger for .NET. So let's have a look there. So here on the left-hand side, I've got the lesson markdown here on GitHub, and on the right, I have an empty VS Code. So today is about HTTP triggers. And if you're new with Azure Functions, or also maybe new to .NET 6, then I'd say it's very important to realize that it's very nice to start with HTTP-based Azure Functions, because HTTP is available all over the place. So it's nice to get started with HTTP and then move on to other types of triggers. Because to get started with HTTP, you just need the Azure Functions runtime. You can run it completely locally, and you're not dependent on any other Azure services. So it's the most lightweight that you can get to get started with Azure Functions using .NET 6. So Azure Functions with .NET 6 is relatively new. I'm not going to talk about all the differences between .NET Core and .NET 6. I think that deserves its own lesson. That will also be probably a bit too much information just for this lesson. So if you're really new to HTTP triggers and to .NET 6, then please stick with me in this lesson, and I'll do a separate one about all the differences between running functions in process in this new isolated out-of-process mode. You do need to install a couple of things. So let's have a look at the prerequisites. So this is the list of the prerequisites for .NET. First of all, you need .NET 6. So if you follow this link, you'll find the installer for your operating system. So you can install .NET 6. It runs cross-platform. I'll be using VS Code for all of the code editing and also running and debugging. I really like VS Code. It's very nice and extensible. Also a cross-platform editor. So I highly recommend that to everyone. In order to enable development of Azure Functions, it's really nice that the Azure team provided a Azure Functions extension for VS Code. So it's very nice and easy to develop Azure Functions and also run it straight from VS Code. Another thing which you probably get already when you install the Azure Functions extension is you need the Azure Functions core tools. So I'm not sure if version 4 already comes pre-installed when you install the Azure Functions extension. So if not, please follow this link and install version 4, because in order to run .NET 6 functions, you need the latest version, and that's v4. And yeah, since we're dealing with HTTP triggers, we need a REST client to actually make HTTP requests, and I'm using the REST client for VS Code, so I can stay in VS Code and do everything from there. But another tool like Postman, for instance, is also a good solution. So that's all you need for these lessons. The rest are prerequisites for other lessons we'll cover a bit later. What you also need is a local workspace. So I already have a folder where I can create my new project in. But if you haven't done that, I recommend you to create a new folder, do a git init, so you actually have version control up and running, and create a folder for your sources. All right, so that's the prerequisites out of the way. And let's start with creating our first function app. So if you have the extension installed, you can go Ctrl-Shift-P or Command-Shift-P, and there's this option called Azure Functions Create New Project. So if you type Azure Functions, you'll see all the commands that are available if you have this extension installed. And we're going to choose Create New Project. So it will step you, it will guide you through a wizard with several steps. And the first thing it will ask, okay, where do you want me to create this new project for you? So in my case, I already created a folder called acfunkuni.htp, and I'd like to create my project in that folder. And it's important to realize that the name of the project will be similar to the name of the folder. So since I create my project in this acfunkuni.htp folder, also my project will have that name. We're going to use C# as the language. And now we need to select the runtime. I want to choose .NET 6, but here we see only .NET Core 3 and .NET 5. And that's because by default, we see the available runtimes for Azure Functions version 3. But this is about .NET 6, and it uses Azure Functions version 4. So we can actually change which Azure Functions version we use. So we even see it's recommended here. So I'm not sure why the wizard is still stuck in V3. But make sure you select version 4, and then you can choose the .NET 6 runtime. And I recommend you to use the isolated process. So there's this difference between isolated and in process. And isolated means you have the Azure Functions runtime running in the run process, and your own functions are running in another process, in the worker process. And these two are completely separated from each other. And with .NET Core, it used to be in the same process, and that caused some difficulties and limitations sometimes. But now you're able to run your function code completely isolated from the .NET runtime, Azure Functions runtime, which allows you quite some benefits. We'll briefly talk about later. So make sure you choose for the isolated .NET 6. And let's select the trigger. Oh, hello, I cannot type anymore. Hello world HTTP trigger. And it asks for a namespace. So a namespace is a logical grouping for your source code. So in this case, we're gonna choose acfunkuni.htp. So that's a namespace I'm putting all my code in. And the final one is about the access rights. I'm going here for the default for a function. When you run everything locally, which we'll be doing in this lesson, you don't need any function code to call out to your Azure Functions. But as soon as you deploy it and you have access rights as function, then you need to provide a function key so your functions cannot be called by anyone. So it's good by default if you leave it at function. Right, now it's creating the project. And let's have a look what kind of files it created. So it says they're unresolved the dependencies. So let's actually restore those dependencies. So we pull in some packages. And let's actually have a look at the CS project file to check what kind of dependencies have been pulled in. Before we do that, let's actually start at the top. So in the CS project file, that defines our project. It defines which framework we are targeting. Well, that's .NET 6. It also defines which Azure Functions version we're using. That's V4. The output type is an exe. So that's also new with regard to .NET Core version. So it's basically a console app, which is running. Then we see it references three packages. If you start at the bottom one, so that's the the base package for your worker process. Then you have the worker SDK, which helps you when you write your Azure functions in VS Code. And there's an extension on the worker, which is specific for our HTTP trigger. Okay, so that's our CS project file. I'll skip our actual function file. We have the host JSON, and that contains, let's say, global configuration for your function app. And by default, it contains some logic, some configuration for logging. In this case, just a minor bit about application insights. You can really extend this quite a bit. I think the link is in the description of all of the things that you can put in this host JSON. You can also specify and override lots of default behavior of your triggers and function bindings in this hosted JSON. If you have any application settings, for instance, API keys or connection strings you want to use, you can put those in your local settings JSON. We won't be touching it today. This file is excluded from Git by default because potentially you could have secrets in there. So I advise you need to not check this in. If you are using application settings and you are deploying your function to Azure, then you need to have these function application settings available in your function app. There is already a deployment lesson. It's almost ready for .6, so I'll make sure it will be available very soon, so you know how to deal with that. You need to deploy your function, including some application settings. Then we have the program CS. It's another thing that is new, and that is the entry point of your worker process. So this contains the startup code for your process, so you have full control of the startup, and that is something that is new with these .NET 6 versions functions. We won't be changing this today, but there will be a lesson very soon about how to configure dependency injection and using some other middleware, and then we'll be updating this program CS file. And finally, there's the trigger. HTTP trigger function itself. So if we just skim through it, so it's a class that's created. We have a private read-only variable for the logger. We have a constructor that receives a logger factory, and the logger factory is used to create an instance for the logger. Then we have our function, and that is a method. And in this case, I'll make this it's on multiple lines so we can see what's going on. So it's an HTTP trigger function, and we're using the HTTP trigger attribute that's using the function authorization level, which we specified in the during the wizard. And this HTTP trigger will be triggered when you do either a GET or a POST to the endpoint. So these are the HTTP verbs or HTTP methods. It will then get an HTTP request data object. So that's it will get this from the Azure Functions runtime. If you have a look what's in there. That HTTP request data that has a body, it has headers, cookies, it has a URI, some identities, the method, so it's the HTTP verb, and a function context that contains some metadata about the function. And also a method to easily create a response based on the request. So that's the input type, but what we send back is an HTTP response data. So that's defined like this. It's almost the same. This contains a status code, which we will be using in this lesson. Again, a collection of headers, a body, cookies, the same context as well. And the method to create a response. Right, so we provide an HTTP request data and we get back an HTTP response data. So what happens inside the function body? Well, first we log a bit of information, just some static text that the HTTP trigger is processing a request. Then on this line, we are creating a response using the method of the request. And we will always responding with an HTTP status code of OK. A header will be added to specify the content type. And a string is written to the output. And then it's returned. All right, so I'm saving this. And let's run this to see if the template is actually working as intended. So I pressed F5. It's now starting up the local Azure Functions runtime. And at a certain moment, it will show a URL that we can call. No, I don't want this. Okay, yeah, so there we are. Let me copy this URL because we are going to call this. And I am going to use the VS Code REST client, and I will create a new file called local tests.http. And in this file, I'm going to write, I'm going to do a GET request to this URL. And I have the REST client installed, I can click on this send request text. That will actually make the request to my local running endpoint. So let's do this, send request, and I get back a 200 OK with welcome to Azure Functions. So the template is working. That's great. Okay, let me stop this. So I now stop the function. Let me close this, we don't need it at the moment. All right, so the basics are working. So that was the first exercise, just making sure you can create a new function just with all the default settings and running it. We didn't do a post. You can also do a post. It will definitely work as well. We'll look into posts in another exercise. So now let's change this template a bit. So let's make sure that this template only works for GET requests. So how can we do that? Oh, I don't need this. Get rid of this. So we can do that by changing the HTTP trigger attribute. So currently it contains two HTTP verbs, the GET and the POST. But if you only want to allow GET requests, then we can just remove this. Why here? So now our function only allows GET requests. And let's say that we also want to provide some input for this function. And so instead of just returning a welcome to Azure Functions all the time, let's make sure that we can provide a name as an input. So we can actually do a, let's say, proper hello world by returning a name that we provide as an input. So the idea is to pass in the name in the query string in a query string variable called name. So we need to extract that. So how do we do that? Well, there is nothing in this HTTP request data to directly extract a query string from the URI. But there are some existing libraries and components in the .NET framework to help us with that. So there's something called the HTTP utility that has a parse query string method. So we're going to use that. But it lives in a different namespace. So we need to add that namespace first. So it lives in the system.web namespace. So I just copied this from the documentation. And I'm going to paste it in the using directives up here. So using system.web. So now I can use code that lives in the HTTP utility class. And let me copy this part. Right. So now I've copied in two lines. One is using the HTTP utility class, the parse query string method, and I'm providing that the request.url.query. And so the request is the type we have here, this HTTP request data. That has a property called URL, and that has yet another property with the query string. And we can use this parse query string method to extract a name value collection from this query string. And then we can use the key. And in this case, we are providing it with a key of name to extract the name value. So now that we have that name, we also want to use it in our output. So that means we have to update this write string method. So again, I'm copy pasting some code from the documentation. So now we're actually using this name, which we extracted from the query string. We're using it in the output here. All right. So let's now run this function. So let's gonna press F5 again. It will start up our local runtime. And we can go back to our local test HTTP function. Use another one. So what we're going to do now is we're going to do a GET request, but we are specifying now the name query string key and give it a value Azure Functions University. So what we will expect as an output then, hello Azure Functions University. So the function app is running locally now and it's all started. So let's press this and let's see what's happening. And we get back a 200 OK, hello Azure Functions University. So that's working. That's perfect. So that's great. But let's see what happens actually when we pass in an empty string. While removing the Azure Functions University, so we still provide the key value. So let's see what happens then. So then we still get a 200 OK, and just saying hello and then nothing. And this is a bit weird, right? So because the function code expects certain parameters like a name value in the query string, but we don't pass it. But then we still get back a 200 OK, and that's a bad practice. So you should always instruct the application or the user that is calling your Azure function. You should always give back appropriate feedback about the request that they made. And in this case, it's not OK. Because we are actually forgetting something in our request. So we could actually change this behavior to return a bad request response instead of an okay response. And that's the next exercise. So let's stop running our local Azure functions. And let's actually implement the bad request response. So here is our function again. Let's make it a bit bigger. Let's get rid of this. All right. Just a small tweak. By default, what VS Code generates is this function attribute, and it has this string value that is the same value as the class name. So I'm not a big fan of all of these string values. So what I usually do is I do name of, then I provide the name of the class. So this has exactly the same meaning. So this is still, let's say, this still results in the string hello world HTTP trigger, but I'm now using the class name in a strongly typed way. So in case I ever want to rename this class, for instance, I want to rename this to hello world HTTP trigger HTTP trigger 3, I can rename it here, and it will be renamed everywhere, like here, 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 and here. So this is a bit easier to work with. So I suggest don't use these magic strings. Try to use this name of. Okay, that has nothing to do with the bad request, but I think it's a nice practice to do. So what we need to do now is we need to check if it actually has a value. So let's do that. So we try to extract the name here from the query string, but it might be empty. So what we can do is if string is null or empty, and we check the name variable. So if name is empty, then we don't want to give back a response with HTTP status code OK. So let's also move this up, but remove this HTTP status code OK. We don't know if it's OK yet. We create a response without supplying the status code, and we will add the header, because that will be the same, because we will always provide back a string message. So if it's null, then we will actually use response.statuscode equals HTTP statuscode bad request. This is much more clearer for the client that made this request, because they will then get this feedback from, I did something wrong, I need to act on this. I will copy paste a few bits just to avoid typing lots of big messages, but it's always very useful to provide back some good instructions. Yeah? So not only a bad request, but it's also important for the client to know, okay, well, why is it a bad request? Well, what is missing? What is incorrect? So in this case, I'm passing back a message. Please provide a value for the name query string parameter. All right. So that's in case the name is null or empty. But in the other situation, then our response is still OK. So then we do response code. This goes, and now it's okay. In this case, we can still do the hello name, because we have the name here. Right, so what did we change? Well, we changed this name off, so we're not using magic strings, but the most important part is we check if the name actually has a value. And we check two things here. Yeah? So either if the name is empty, so if it's an empty string, or the name is not defined at all, so if it's null. So there are two different situations. And if it's empty, we'll give back a bad request. And if it's not empty, then we give back the status code OK. So let's run this code. And let's test this. And it's important to realize now that I've renamed this this function to hello world HTTP trigger 3. So I also need to update my local test with HTTP trigger 3. So the local Azure Function Runtime is up and running. So let's call this now, and we have provided a query string parameter name with a value. So this should actually get us back the 200 OK. And it does. Hello, AC Funk Uni. So that's working. Cool. But now let's remove this. So now the value is empty. So now it should not return a 200 OK. And indeed, we get a 400 bad request. Please provide a value for the name query string parameter. So that's excellent. But also in this case, when we don't provide the name key at all, again, it should result in a 400. And indeed, 400 bad request. Okay, cool. So that's all working. Well, let's stop this. All right. So and now, what if we call the Azure function? We get back a meaningful response, and then that's important. But sometimes, we cannot deal with GET requests. We have to actually pass in some more data, and that's usually not done via query strings, but that's usually done in the body of a request. So let's see how we can handle POST requests, because with a POST, you can put something in the body, and the Azure function can read it from the body and do something with it. So let's update our function, and let's add back that we can also do posts. So first thing that we do is we look up the HTTP verbs in the HTTP trigger attribute, and we add the post again. So now the function can handle both GET and posts. But now we have to make our function a bit more intelligent, because currently we are checking the piercing collection, but we only need to do that when we are processing GET requests. Because when we are processing POST requests, then there won't be anything in the query string, because we need to meet the name from the body. And that's done in a different way. What we do then is we check the method of the request. So what we do is if the requests dot method, if that equals a GET, and I'm always going to string person, we're going to check the method property of the request, and if that equals GET, and by doing it like this, if we do equals GET string comparison ordinal ignore case, then no matter if it's uppercase or lowercase, this will be a match. So if you do equals with strings, always make sure you do ignore the case. If that's need important, in this case it's important, but because most likely this method will be uppercase, and I'm using a lowercase here. So it's always safe to use ignore casing when you check for strings. So if it is a GET method, then I want to do this part about the query string. And name variable, I'll declare it here. String name, and I'm going to set it to a default value, which is empty. So I'm going to define the name parameter first, and this either will be set by reading it from a query string, or it will be retrieved from the body. So we can retrieve it from the body by doing a request read as a string async. All right, I'll explain the rest quickly part in a second. So we check the method property of the request. If it's equal to GET, then we read it from the query string. If it's not equal to GET, then this is a POST. So we can read it from the body using this read as string async method. You could be very explicit and you could do else if request method equals POST. But since I have these HTTP verbs mentioned here, it's either a GET or a POST. So I'm pretty sure that this is only then in case of a POST. You could also extend this with other HTTP verbs, like put and then delete and things like that. So then you would need to make this a bit more explicit in case you do a put and delete. So we have a bit of asynchronous code here. We are reading a string from the body, and we're doing that asynchronously, we need to await that because our function cannot continue before we actually have a name extracted from the body. But our function is not asynchronous. And that's actually a requirement if you are using the await keyword. So we can change this function to be async, typing the async keyword here. But async methods always return a task. It's either a just a task or a task with a... Or in this case, it returns a task of the original type it returns. So it's a task of HTTP response data. And you have to make sure to import the correct task type. So there are different task types in the .NET framework. And we need the system.threading.tasks. So that's the proper return type for this case. Okay, so the red squiggles are gone now. So we've defined a name. We either return it from the query string or we return it from the body. And then we are going to use it in our response. Here we see some more squiggles here because we are already using async code, but we were not awaiting it yet. And since our entire function is now async, it's good at it also. Use the await keywords here. Okay, so now everything is properly formatted. Okay, so let's save it and let's run this function. And let's call it. Gonna copy the REST client code again. No. So in this case, we're going to do a post, and it's going to hello world HTTP trigger 3 in this case. When you do a post, you always have to specify the content type. So in this case, it's still plain text. So content type text slash plain, and we're providing Azure Functions University. So when we do this, we expect hello Azure Functions University. So let's call this. And indeed, it's 200K. Hello, functions and university. Cool. Now, if we still do a post with a content type, but keep the body empty, then what should happen? The bad request code is still in there. So when we do this, we should get a 400 back bad request. Exactly. The only thing is that our information in the response is not correct because we are talking about a name query string now, but we're doing a post. So our message should actually include something that provide a name in the body. So there's one thing to improve still. Okay, so this is for plain text handling. But what actually is more common is to provide some JSON content here when we do post. And then in our function code, we can actually map or let's say deserialize our JSON object into a .NET type. So that's very often done. So that's going to be our next exercise, doing post requests with JSON data. So let's stop the execution of our local function. And let's create a whole entire copy of our function now. And let's name it Hello World HTTP Trigger 5. And let's rename this 5 now. 5, 5, 5. Oh. And this is 5 and 5. So we got the exact same function as the previous exercise, exercise 4. But now let's change this to work with JSON data types. So instead of passing in a string in the body, we will passing in an object. In this case, it will be a very small object, and it will only have run property named name. And our function will expect that the body has a certain type. So let's assume that we have a person type, which you can see here. And our body will then deserialize the JSON into a .NET type, into this record. And we can use that record then in our function. So let's first create a new class, new file. Okay, and this will be our person record. So if you haven't heard of records, they look a lot like classes, but they're usually intended for immutable objects. So you create an instance of it with certain properties, and they don't change from the moment. So in this case, we have a person record with just one property called name. It lives in the same namespace as our function code. If you happen to choose a different namespace, then you have to make sure that you include this namespace in your function code. So let's go back to our Hello World HTTP trigger 5. And let's now assume that this one will not accept any GET requests. This one will only handle POST requests. So we're only gonna accept POST requests, and we expect a body with one of these person records in the body. So we can get rid of the checking the methods, right? Because we won't be doing any GET calls. So we can actually get rid of all this. And instead of getting the name from the body, you're going to use another method, and that is read from JSON async. And that's a generic method. We specify which type we expect to be in the body. So in this case, we are expecting a type person. So what happens? So this method will read the body. It will transform the JSON into a person object. So now we have this person variable, and this person variable has a name property, and we can use this person name instead of the separate name variables used here. So everywhere where name is used, you will use person.name. Okay, so these are the required changes. So we've now extracted a person record type from the request, and we are creating a response, and we are checking if the person name is null or empty, and if so, it's still a bad request. But now let's also update this text to not refer to the query string, and please provide a value for the name in the JSON body, so it's clear to the client in case they receive a bad request what's going on. All right, and that should be it. So let's run this function. So what we need to do now is again use the REST client. Here we go. And we will do a just a wrong thing. So we're going to do a post to this Hello World trigger HTTP 5. And now our content type is application JSON. So this is now a JSON body with one property name called Azure Function University. And this should result in a record type of person that has a name property with the same value. So everything is running. So let's make the request and see if it's working. Yeah, we get a 200 OK. And hello, Azure Function University. Cool. So it's working. And in case you leave this empty, we should get a bad request. Find a value for the name in the JSON body. Excellent. All right, so now you know how to do GET request and POST request. And very importantly, work with JSON data, which is really very common. So now let's have a look at one thing you can extend your function with is using routes. So in our case, we're always doing the return from hello, Azure Function University, right? But what if you want to change the greeting? So instead of hello, you want to do hi, or hey, or hola. So you can do that by, putting other different variables or parameters in the body by doing POST requests. But you can also update the route and add some custom route parameters to handle that. So let's create a copy of the first Hello World HTTP trigger. And let's change that for this exercise. So let's rename this to World HTTP trigger 6. And let's update numbers again to 6. Okay, and this one will only do GET requests. That doesn't even matter. We can also still allow POST requests. That's fine. What is important is that we will change the route. So what we will do. Hello. So what we will do, we will extend this HTTP trigger with another parameter called route. And what we have to provide here is the full route of the endpoint that we're going to call. So in this case, usually the by default, the route always contains the name of the function. So we can still reuse that, but it can be anything else. So the game is just be hello 6, for instance. In this case, I'm using the full method name. But now let's add a route parameter called greeting. So this is the name of the parameter. And you can also restrict these parameters by using certain type restrictions. So that's what I'm going to do now. I'm going to say this is only alpha values are allowed for this greeting. So that means only letters, either uppercase or lowercase, but no numbers, no spaces, no other other characters. And I want it to be an optional route parameter. So in case we don't specify this, then we just fall back to the hello greeting. So we can do that by providing this question mark. So our endpoint will be available at this route. And so it will be the name, but then slash, and then a greeting. So that could be hi or hey, or it could be removed. So we use no greeting, and then we'll use the default greeting. So now that we have this route parameter, we want to use it in our function. And right now we don't have access to this greeting parameter. So in order for us to do that, we need to add it to our function arguments, to this method argument. So let's add it in greeting. Now we can use the greeting inside our response. So here, what we can do here is instead of giving back hello, we can do greeting. But let's say in case the greeting is empty, then it should result in the default. So it should be like this. Is this correct? Oh, wait, this still needs some quotes. So we've specified the custom route parameter here in the route greeting. We have added a greeting parameter in the function method. And we are using that parameter when we write back to the output. But in case there is no value for the greeting, we will fall back to hello. Because this is a no coalescing operator. Okay, let's save this and let's test it in some different ways now. So let's run this. And let me copy this here. Okay. Let's go back to our local test code. Here we go. No, we don't want this. Okay, so what we have here is, oh, this is still an old URL. This is not the correct one. So this is the URL. So the end we have is hello world HTTP trigger 6 and then slash, and then we use hi. So this is our greeting then, and then we use the name Azure Functions University. So we expect a response, hi Azure Functions University. So let's see if this is working. Indeed, hi Azure Functions University. All right, so let's see. Okay, so this also could be, hey Azure Functions University. All right. But you can also just remove it. Now it's removed, so now it should fall back to hello. Hello, Azure Functions University. All right, so that seems to be working. Cool. Okay, let's stop our local function runtime again. Okay, so what I've shown so far is, well, how to create a new HTTP trigger function from scratch using VS Code and using the .NET 6 isolated template, changing the template to only allow GET requests, to change the output to also indicate when a request goes wrong, to also use POST request by using string data and JSON data from the request, and also using the route attributes and custom attributes in the route. So I think that's already quite a lot to get you started with Azure Functions and HTTP triggers and .NET 6. There's also some homework for this lesson. Let me quickly show you. So the homework is related to creating your own resume based on Azure Functions. So the assignment is create an Azure function with an HTTP trigger that returns your resume information in JSON output. And for this initial assignment, it's fine if you just hard code the output in the Azure function. There will be more lessons where we integrate storage services as well. So you can build this out in a very fancy way. But for now, you can just hard code this in. For instance, by creating one of these person records and adding more properties to that and return that as the JSON output. There are some additional resources here. I will also add a few more related to the .NET 6 isolated mode part. If you have questions about the homework or you want to share or show your homework, please do a shout out on Twitter. You can always mention me at Mark Duiker. You can also mention the hashtag ACFunkUni as well. Next to that, if you want more information, there's quite a lot of information on Azure Functions and also HTTP triggers on the official documentation by Azure. So please check that out. And yeah, very soon we will extend this lesson with some dependency injection configuration and also using Refit. So if you're keen on learning more what you can do with HTTP and Azure Functions, yeah, then definitely subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already, because there'll be quite some more lessons about this soon. I'll stop sharing. So yeah, thanks again. This YouTube channel reached 1K subscribers today, so I'm very thankful for that. Again, if you want to help to contribute to the lesson, please do reach out. I'm always very happy if people do that, and I'm also eager to help you out with that. And you can also co-host a show with me, which I always enjoy. If you have any other questions or improvements for lessons, please do let me know. And until the next lesson, bye everyone.